And even the long-term management of your patient once he's in hospital now, it's an extremely resource-intensive condition, spinal cord injuries. They need extensive multidisciplinary care, and there's so many things to consider. So thromboembolism is one of the big things. They've got a lot of risk factors, venostasis, immobilization, hypercoagulability, and trauma, which leads to hypercoagulability. And they recommend prophylaxis in the form of heparin, compression stockings, etc., for at least 3 to 6 months after the injury. At that point, you can stop. Most of the majority of cases of DVT and pulmonary embolism were reported within the first 3 to 6 months. So it's not lifelong. They suffer from severe postural hypertension, again due to their inability to host a sympathetic reaction due to some decrease in blood pressure, and can lead to loss of consciousness, so on. Then there's a phenomenon called autonomic dysreflexia. It's also happening in patients with high T-spine and C-spine levels, where any form of irritation distal to the level of the injury, and this usually only develops later, like in your more chronic cases, like a distended bladder or distended bowel or ingrown toenail, any form of irritation that they cannot feel, causes this autonomic response where they get facial flushing, severe hypertension, tachycardia, sometimes fever, they can pass out, they can have a fit, they can have a heart attack. It's actually quite dangerous. And you should be aware of this when you're treating spinal cord injury patients, and they should be educated about it. And basically how you treat this is you just remove whatever the offending thing was. You unblock a block catheter, you give an enema, you cut the donor. But in the acute phase, you also want to maybe lower the blood pressure by using either the nifedipine or putting the patient in an upright position. Urinary complications are quite common. You can imagine they lose their bladder and bowel function, they have frequent urinary tract infections, they can develop stricture from catheterization, and quite a few paraplegics end up having chronic renal failure. Some gastrointestinal considerations, and this also starts in your acute phase, is like we said, aspiration of gastric contents is quite a large cause of death, so you have to put an empty tube for these patients, and then they will have post-traumatic ileus, bowel distension, delay gastric emptying, and also need to protect them against stress ulceration in the initial phases. And they will almost invariably suffer from constipation throughout their life, so it's important to institute a bowel regime of regular laxatives and enemas to prevent that. And then the logical considerations is obviously pressure ulcers, and it's also a pressure source. And it's also recommended that the management of this, or the prevention of the stots in cavities, take the patient off the spinal board and to early log rolling. And then you have to address the psychological issues. Very prone to develop depression, with bulls and suicide, it is obviously a psychological stressor. Anyway, so in conclusion, what we can do is we can prevent secondary spinal cord injury, we can prevent associated complications, and then of course encourage early rehabilitation and address psychological issues. There's a few pictures, but you can't really see them particularly well, so I'm just going to skip that one. And this one. There you can see it's between C6 and C7. That degree of subluxation is usually associated with a unilateral facet. Dislocation. That degree of subluxation is associated with a bilateral facet joint dislocation. And then that was with 40 pounds of traction. See how much traction it is now. And look, this isn't going to reverse the original injury, but it will prevent. Yes?
I'm sorry, I still don't understand this traction. Did you see if you attach the tongs?
Yes.
And then
where you
hang the traction,
The tongs have the little hook. And then it's the same skeletal traction, it's the same.
It's like a kind of
And you put the patient slightly in the head up position so that his body weight provides counter traction. And then the same pulley system that they use for simple skeletal traction is also adequate. Then if you're going to do it, I recommend trying to do it in theater, so that you can sedate the patient, but we can't knock him out because you have to test his neurology, and then so you can use the C-arm, so otherwise you have to send the patient next week. And it will work out.
Hey.